Hi, my name is Daniel, and I'm going to be working with Alan here to host our very special Walking Wounded panel. We have with us today Helen and Kevin, and all of us are part of the Walking Wounded Detachment. This is a group that is kind of works to be a little bit of a support system to people who are working working on battling through something or who deal with longer term challenges. I've also found that this group has some of the biggest hearts of anyone in this community because we all know exactly what it's like to have to deal with something a little bit harder. So thank you guys for being here with us today. This is the third time that we have been able to host the Walking Wounded, and we are honored that you joined us. Alan, I think you had a question to kind of start us off.
Yeah, I'm going to start off a little bit. First thing I'd like to say, happy holidays, everybody. And from the Walking Wounded to the community. The first question for the panelists is, what are some of the most memorable moments that happened to you being with the Walking Wounded and a member of the Star Wars fandom?
I guess I
Let's
could.
start off with Helen.
Okay.
Okay. I've had a couple. I be due to some knee problems and some back problems, I use a Rollator to walk most of the time. And I've had troops happen where other disabled or differently abled people saw that, and I could see it registered for them. I've walked onto baseball fields at minor league baseball games pushing the Rollator. And I was no different than any other trooper, but I think it made a connection for people in the audience who are not used to seeing themselves up there, so to speak. Because as we've all learned, representation matters, and it especially matters for kids. And I see that particularly on troops with kids.
Okay, good. Very nice. Kevin?
Yeah, I've had a similar situation with like the Children's Hospital here in town when we've done visits. And we've had kids that have been kind of hesitant and sitting back, kind of laid back. And we'd go up and talk to them. And they're like, oh, I don't feel comfortable because I hurt all the time and all this and that. And then I leaned over and told them, I said, you know what? I do too. But the reason I'm here is to make you happy. And from then on, I just had to cling on the entire troop, little kid clinging onto my leg because he finally understood that there were people out there like him, with disabilities like he had, and that understood the pain he was going through.
That's very good, very nice. I mean, I know myself, I've had things similar to that too, where kids, didn't understand, and I say, hey, I'm walking with diabetes, and I have, a disability on my leg, and they're like, wow, it's pretty good. So it does give motivational to the kids. Daniel, how about you?
It's interesting, Kevin, that you mentioned the Children's Hospital. I actually had a similar experience there a couple of years ago that I wrote about in a blog I do from time to time, not very faithfully, I'm afraid. But I was actually there as a patient, and so when my wife and I were there, we were sort of walking around the ward because I'm not very good at staying in rooms where they tell me to stay, and we. This is a children's hospital. We kept running into these rooms, and if you've ever been in a hospital, the rooms are like really dimly lit most of the time. And you can kind of see the parents silhouetted against, the cribs. I don't know what you call them, but where they put the, and we got to talk to a couple of them. And, I'm sitting there wearing the stupid hospital gown they give you, the one that never quite closes the right way. And, it's sort of a weird situation, but it was oddly uplifting, I guess, because I was able to say, hey, I know that this is hard now, but look, there's hope. I'm here. I was where your kid was at one point, and I'm here. There is a way through it. And I don't know that I would have known to do that without some of what we do here, I think. So that's actually a question that I have for the rest of you. Is has being in the Walking Wounded given you more of a, I don't know, a sense of awareness or a heart for others who maybe aren't in the 501st that are going through, things that are hard like that? So why don't we start with Kevin this time?
I think it gives you a little bit more compassion towards people because you have a better understanding of what people are going through. You know, my injury, I fell onto a concrete pad from about 40 feet and was in a coma for 3 days. And ever since then, I've just never been right. I mean, my body temperature isn't regulated. I'm in pain all the time. But, you know, thankfully the VA takes care of me. But when I see people in a wheelchair or I see kids that are going through situations, I can kind of connect on a better level with them because I have a better understanding of what they're going through day to day and, you know, letting them know, you know, being an example that, you know, you can get through this. You can work through it. One way or another, you're going to find your stride.
That's a good answer. And I think that, you know, your point about sort of persevering through something is well taken, especially from someone who's kind of been there. Helen, what about you?
I think being in the Walking Wounded detachment has made me a better trooper, because sometimes when you have face it, for us, trooping is hard. Trooping is hard to begin with. For us, it's doubly, if not triply so, because we're dealing with physical issues or maybe sometimes some psychological issues you don't necessarily see. Just to be able to get out there and attend a troop, much less suit up and get into costume and interact with people. But being in the detachment, as Kevin had mentioned, it's perseverance. It helps me knowing everybody in the detachment has my back. Everybody understands that trooping is hard. That's motivational for me. And that's why I say I think it's the Walking Wounded detachment's made me a better trooper. It's, you know, I might have, you know, in the past just said, okay, maybe it was a little too physically difficult for me today and not gone to a troop, because I know everybody else and everybody on this call has got my back about it. I might be more likely to push through it and go to the troop. And I often find that when I put my Jawa on, I'm instantly in a better mood and everything else picks up. But I'm able to do that because I know the detachment has my back.
Yeah, that's a really good point. And I can, I've certainly seen that too. You know, it's sometimes it's harder to get there than it is to actually, do the troop once you're there and suit it up. Alan, I know you have a real heart for issues like this. What's your take?
Well, I mean, it is. I mean, first thing is, everybody's saying what they're saying, and it's very, very good. And I understand exactly what you all are talking about. But I do get very, I guess, say motivational or motivated. And also, I get emotional with things like this, too. Seeing like myself, there's a lot of things I can't do, but I still do it. When I get in costume, when I'm like the guy behind me, Dooku, my mindset is different than when I'm just myself. I feel like I can do more, I can do better. And then also the smiles that I see on people's faces and the kids coming over and saying, when they mention that, that some of them say Count Dooku, some of them say that I'm someone else, but that's another story. But it's kind of, it's very heartwarming. And that kind of makes me keep on going. And then also I see, like, for example, as everybody probably knows that know me, I'm previous military. So I have a lot of the military people come over to me and say, hey, that's cool. Can I do something like this? But, you know, I got, and they tell me that, you know, I was in war, I was in certain battles and I've had issues. I said, that doesn't change it. It's not the mindset. It's the community around you that keeps you going. And it's hard, and Daniel knows that it's hard for me to talk about this because it gets pretty emotional on my side. But it's, if I could put a smile on somebody's face and I could just be myself and help somebody get through things and vice versa, the walking wounded people, they have taught me many, many times. I mean, many times I said, I just can't do it anymore. It's done. I mean, Daniel knows, he's been at events with me where I say, I have to sit down. I'm sorry. It's time. But that's kind of how I get through it, you know, and it's the people around me that get me through it. It's not really myself. It's the people around me, the strength, the hearts that are helping me get through things. So that's it for me.
But that's thanks. A great answer. Thank you for that. Alan, I think when we were
talking, my turn.
You said, yeah. Yeah, you said you might have another question or two for us.
Yeah, I do. And on that same thing is, I know we all do a lot of trooping. Now, everybody out here does a trooping, but what I'd like to know from our walking wounded panel is, what type of modifications do you make to your costumes to make it workable so you can troop? Helen?
In my case, I do a Jawa. Right now, my one approved costume is a Jawa. So I haven't had to make any modifications to the costume in order to be able to troop. However, the costume, the choice makes a difference, because on occasion I don't wear them as often as I should, but I have metal braces that run from about mid thigh to mid calf for both my legs. If I'm in a Jawa, you can't see them. They're completely covered. So in that case, the costume actually, as is actually a good choice for me. But I do also have, my husband made for me a lightsaber cane that I've used on troops. It's an Ultra Saber's Tanfa handle, and he got a heavy duty Lucite for the blade part, and I use that during troops as well.
Wow. Very creative, very creative. It's kind of cool. I'd like to see that sometime. I'm sure everybody would. It's pretty cool. But now, how about you, Kevin?
When I first started out, I was doing like Vader and Boba Fett, and they tend to be very heavy costumes. And as I've gotten older and longer in the tooth in my 501st Legion career, I've tended to migrate towards lighter costumes that I could spend more time in, because it's one thing to be able to, you know, work for like an hour or two in a Vader and then have to bow out. And it's another thing to work as an Imperial officer where you're just like a face character and you can actually be a minder to the rest of the crew as well. And it just makes it a lot more comfortable for me. And it gives me an opportunity to drive droids around like kids play with, like BB-8 and R2 and all the different droids that I bring out to troops. And, you know, kids have a blast. So I may not portray a Darth Vader or Boba Fett anymore, but, you know, I give the kids the joy of being able to drive a droid, which they'd probably never be able to do.
Yeah, it's always warming to be able to see that, especially with the kids and so on. You're able to help them out, and they're having a hell of a lot of fun. Sorry about the cussing. But now, Daniel, how about you?
So I guess with me, I actually have a pacemaker. So with me, you know, like magnets are kind of a big no-no. Like, you really don't want to wave those around. It's kind of what they tell you. So the modifications haven't been too bad. It means little things, you know, like not using magnets to attach stuff, or even just being careful what I walk next to. Like, a few months ago, I got a call from the cardiologist saying, like, you had some weird glitch, and it was like right in the middle of the convention thing. We still don't know what happened, you know, so it's just kind of being aware. But for me, most of it is just being aware of my own limitations. You know, I can wear, you know, most costumes, but there's a point at which I need to, you know, stop or take a break or something, because it just, I can't physically keep going. And that's hard. I don't know if you guys have had the same experience, but when you troop with people who don't have that kind of limitation, the temptation is just to keep going because everybody else is still going. And I've had to learn that sometimes you just got to say, you know, well, you know, you guys go ahead, I'll catch up, you know, when I can. That's been the tough one for me.
It's tough on a lot of people. And that's what you have to do. Is the biggest thing, like you said, is making sure you know your limitations, as that famous Clint Eastwood saying was. But anyways, Daniel, I think you did have another question.
I do. But first, I do want to point out, so we are here today talking about The Walking Wounded, and this whole thing, the whole InfernoCon, the holiday special returns, is in support of Make-A-Wish, which, you know, if you're not familiar with the organization, it's a group that does a lot of good for kids who are going through some of these really tough times. I've been watching our stream, and while we have been on, the four of us have been on here, we've had several donations come in. That's really great to see. And I think that this group especially has, you know, such a big heart for things like that, that, you know, it really pleases me to see that here. And I know that, you know, you guys are right there with me. So my question kind of builds off the last one. So, you know, how do you modify your costumes? And we talked about that. But I guess the question that I have is, this is one detachment. You know, we have all these other detachments in the 501st, you know, the Jolly Rogers and the, you know, the FISD, you know, the Stormtrooper guys. How is this detachment different? You know, what makes this detachment unique and sort of set apart from all of the other detachments that you see in the 501st and, you know, in some of the other organizations? Alan, why don't we start with you this time? You've been last every other time, so.
Thanks. This detachment actually is, like, we know, it's part of the same, my heart and soul is into this. It is totally different than any other detachment. It takes, basically, first thing is you don't have to be part of the 501st to be in here. You could be Rebel Legion, you could be whatever you need. Also, you don't have to be part of the, you just have to like Star Wars. You can be an outside source. I have a few people that are in there that not even interested in joining one of our organizations, but they're so interested in what we do with the Walking Wounded. And of course, that's to support our own people, support other people, and just be, you know, like I'm throwing out there, supportive. The reason why I joined them was I actually originally had one of the ideas, and it just happened that the one that runs the head dog, as they say, Albion, he said, hey, we have something like this already. It's not that big, but we're doing it. And I said, can I help out? And he, you know, kind of let me roll with the flow, and it really was a good thing. I mean, it shows that it helps me see and hear from people that I probably wouldn't hear from in the regular organization. They also open up and I get to hear their stories. And there's a lot of good stories out there, and they're actually live stories. They're real stories. They're not like some, you know, I hate to use it, but it's not like a Star Wars or a whatever. It's real stories. This is what people are going through. And if I'm able to help them, it's a good thing. And this is one of the ways I do it, through the Walking Wounded detachment. You know, and that's about it. I mean, I'm not going to throw a lot of other stuff, but I think y'all get what I get. But, and on the other side, remember, we are, like Daniel said earlier, if anyone wants to do some sort of donation, they're just like us. They have particular issues that we can help by just putting some sort of supportive money. And I'll be honest with you. I mean, after I'm done with here, I know I'm taking a little more time, but I'll make a deal with anybody. I'm going to put $100 donation. Let's see if anyone can beat me. Okay. I'm going to put $100 right after we get done with this for a donation and see how many people can do it. And I want to see if you can do it and beat me. So that's my ending right there.
That's a great ending, Alan. You know, it's been an honor to work on this. If you guys don't know, Alan has been one of the guys who's helped organize this whole thing. So he probably deserves your sympathy for having to sit through all of the meetings where I sort of went on and on and on. But that was a great answer. And Kevin, I'm curious, have you had sort of a similar experience to Alan, I'll get there, in terms of what the Walking Wounded Detachment means, as opposed to what maybe another detachment might mean for you?
Sure. as people outside 501st may not know, each of the detachments specializes in a certain costume, type of costume. Like we'll have the regular stormtroopers, the biker scouts, the TIE pilots, and so forth. Well, our detachment, the walking wounded, does not have a costume type. We don't fight over CRL specification, you know, costume reference library specifications. We are strictly there, you know, to come together as a group and help, you know, help each other out and understand that everybody that is in the detachment has, you know, it could be something from mental illness, a physical illness, you know, severe depression. And no matter what time of day, time of year, someone's always there to help out. So if someone has a problem or, you know, just wants to gripe about the day, you know, hey, it's been tough, you know, there's always someone there that's going to jump on board and help you out. And that's what I like, the fostering, you know, the fostering of a family, a community of people that genuinely care about each other. And, you know, we'll even check up on people. It's like, hey, I haven't heard from so-and-so in a while, you know? So that's where we're a little bit different as a detachment from the rest of the Legion.
So Helen, we kind of saved the best for last year, I think. And I saw you nodding in agreement when Kevin mentioned like checking up on people.
Yeah.
Right? Is that something you can elaborate a little more on?
That's actually something, there's a couple people I have gotten to talking to because of, you know, on Facebook and in forums through the Walking Wounded Detachment, that we do keep tabs on each other, you know, and check in. And it made me think that there is somebody in particular, Jennifer, if she's watching the panel, I owe her a message to see how she's doing, that we do differ in that we're not costume driven. We're not costume specific, and we're not organization specific, because we cut across all of them. As Alan had said, we have members who aren't even in any of the organizations. And actually, I started that way myself. I was not in, I became a 501st honorary in October 2009. So I was already an honorary member of the 501st, but I wasn't a costumed member when I became part of the detachment. It was only after I was a member of the detachment that I got approved with a costume. But it's our focus on people rather than costumes. I think that actually fosters or facilitates the relationships we form with people, because we do check in on each other. I think it makes us a little bit more people focused than maybe some of the other detachments. And I'm a very proud member of Krait Klan. I want to give a shout out to them. Don't get me wrong. But Walking Wounded, not being tied to a costume, it allows us to form those relationships with each other.
That's a great answer. Thank you so much for elaborating on that. I really like the point that you made about how you know, people are kind of the focal point. I think that's something that sometimes it's easy to forget, you know, that we're not just what we're wearing. There's, you know, somebody underneath the mask. I'm going to flip back over to Alan here. I can see he's just bursting with anticipation for his next question. So what you got for us, Alan?
Yeah, this is going to be a kind of a fun question. I mean, it's really simple and sweet, but each one of you all, can you kind of tell like one of your best stories of your, it doesn't have to be through the 501st. It doesn't have to be through the Walking Wounded, just all around of, how, you know, something that you feel that went really well that makes you proud of what you did. Helen?
First thing that comes to mind actually is not, I was at a troop as a handler, and it was my husband's first troop after he joined in 2009. And we were at a Maria Freire Children's Hospital in Valhalla, New York. And the whole troop, when we were going through the wards, everybody kept telling us, you can't leave without seeing Frankie. Every nurse repeated the same line. So we get to Frankie's room and he was out for a treatment. And it was our time was up. We were getting ready to leave. So the guys are walking to the elevator, and we were all kind of bummed we didn't get to meet this kid named Frankie when they wheeled him off the elevator. And oh my goodness, this poor child, his whole head was in bandages. You could see surgical scars, but so really all we could see were his eyes, but the way his eyes shot open. His mother started to cry about how happy he was to see us. And we had toys to share with him. So we were able to give him some toys, and we had that few minutes before we left. Jump forward to the same troop 4 years later, when we have a backdrop we had set up for Blaster Trooper. And I see this kid with long tousled blonde hair running around, runs up, "Grandma, Grandma, can I have money to go do the Blaster Trooper?" And I hear her say to the kid, "Sure, Frankie, here's $5. So he runs off, and I turn to her and I say, "Ma'am, do you mind if I ask you a question about your grandson?" And she's like, "Oh, no, not, I don't mind." So was he a patient here about 4 years ago? And she turns to me and said, "Oh, yeah, that's when he almost died, when he was attacked by the pit bull." Ugh. It was the same Frankie.
Hmm.
And he looked amazing. And he was jumping around and happy to see us. And she looked at me and said, "Wait, were you here?" And we got to talking. And it was just so gratifying that this kid, one, survived all those injuries. But he was happy and joyous and running around like a 9-year-old should.
That's a remarkable story.
Yeah, that's just amazing. And it's what you're telling me. I get emotional a lot, but you got a little proudness and tear in the eye. So very, very nice, Helen. Daniel, I'm going to have you go next.
Yeah, so we started doing this in the whole InfernoCon thing last year when everybody was stuck inside, and we all kind of got to fall, the fall, and said, we need to do something, we can't just go the whole year and not do something, because we all kind of miss the Toys for Tots troops and things like that we usually do. So we pulled one of these together, and we kind of made it up as we went. I don't know anyone who had done one of these. So we were just kind of trying to figure it out as we went. And I knew from the beginning that I wanted to do a Walking Wounded panel. And when I joined the Walking Wounded, there was a Facebook group that had just started. I mean, it's been a while. For the longest time, it was just sort of a list on a piece of paper. And I had a homemade banner that I brought out every now and then. And I would tell people, "Hey, I'm in the Walking Wounded." But this is the first time that I thought, "Hey, we've got a platform. We can put this group somewhere where other people can see them." So the whole thing was, the whole event was super stressful for me. But we got to the Walking Wounded panel. I was hosting it. And my first thought was, "Oh man, I got to get through this thing without bungling it, dropping something or, mispronouncing someone's name or something." And so we went through it, and I thought, that went okay. No one, stormed out in a fit of rage or anything. So I guess we did okay. And the remarkable thing that started happening is in the days and weeks after that, I would hear from people saying, "Hey, I didn't know about that group. Thank you for letting us know." And I started seeing new names pop up on the Facebook group, and they said, "Hey, I heard about it at this event." And in fact, I even met some people in my own squad that were had either just joined or were already members. I didn't know about it. There was a whole support system there that I didn't know anything about. People that were going through some of the same things, I've been through, I didn't know anything about. And it sort of, the lesson that kind of impressed is, this group is so valuable, not because of what I can get out of it, but because of what I can give to other people just by sharing it, just by taking an opportunity to say, "Hey, this is here. You're not by yourself. We're here and we're standing, with you and behind you. And, one way or another, we're going to help get you through this. You're not by yourself. You're not alone." So hopefully that's not too rambling, Alan. But
no, Daniel, that was great, Daniel. And I know exactly what you're talking about. And you get that smile, you get that feeling. You know you're doing the right thing. So, Kevin.
Yeah, I'm leaning towards kind of what the Legion does and what costume groups do with the Make-A-Wish Foundation. One of my first troops was as Darth Vader, and we were going down to visit a young boy who requested a visit from Darth Vader and a bunch of his friends. So we went down, and, you know, it turned out he was dying of leukemia. He was having a really hard time. And, you know, he spent a lot of time with me, and I was like, well, why is Darth Vader your favorite character? And, you know, because he specifically asked for him. And he said, because I know there's good in him. And I know if somebody loved him, that he would go to the good side. And, you know, something like that just kind of makes you're thankful you have a helmet on, because you're crying because this little boy has learned the most valuable thing in life is that the only thing that really matters in this life is loving one another and taking care of each other. And, you know, he passed away a couple months after, you know, we kept in touch, but he passed away. But it was such a pleasure to work with the Make-A-Wish Foundation and to be a part of his life and him knowing that he made Darth Vader good that day. And that was all he ever wanted to do.
Wow. And that, wow. That's all I have to say. I can't say anything else to that except for wow. I know where I'm kind of asked the question, but I'm also going to answer the question myself, because I had something too, if y'all don't mind. I had a situation where it was a Make-A-Wish style event that happened over at Ionova. I went in there, a few other people went with me, but I met this kid and he pointed me out. He says, "You're Count Dooku." And I was trying, you know, I played the character, but he really believed that I was Count Dooku. And I had a little, you know, I had the lightsaber. I had him do a little lightsabering with me, and I gave him one of my cards. And sorry.
No, take your time.
Okay. But anyways, I gave the cards, and it's a card of mine. And what happens is, later on, I was talking with the parents, and the parents kept in touch with me because he kept on talking about Count Dooku, how he met him. He actually passed away. Hold on. And then his mom said that he had my card when he passed away. And he said that he wanted to be buried with it. It's okay. I'm finished.
I can fully understand. It's you. When the Make-A-Wish Foundation grants a wish to some child, and, you know, that's all they want, you know, they're meeting their heroes. They're meeting people that they've always wanted to meet. And, you know, this was probably the only time they'd ever get to see him. And I cannot stress that, you know, if you can donate today towards the Make-A-Wish, you know, Foundation's endowment fund, it does great work. Some of the stories that you've heard today, you know, it really makes a difference in these children's lives. And that's part of the reason why I love suiting up. And I'm sure all of us do. Yeah. And I commend you for, you know, making that young boy's dream come true. And, you know, he will always have a part of you. You'll always have a part of him in your heart.
And you have to remember that most of the character I play is face characters. So I don't have the helmet. It's, you know, it's hard to hold it in because, you know, but a lot of times you just let it go because they understand. And, you know, they ask you, why do you cry? And, you know, you try not to tell them. You say, you know, I'm just happy to be here with you, you know? And like you were saying, Make-A-Wish does a lot more than just making wishes. They make lives, you know, and especially for the parents and all that, because they see their kid, especially I mean, I couldn't even think about my child passing away, you know, when they know that he is only one way down the road. And the only way, and they have to remember also Make-A-Wish does the Make-A-Wishing, but they also, you know, help support the families to get there and be with their kids during this event that we do. But anyways, it's enough on that. But anyways, I hope everybody continues to donate. I'm about ready to get my donation in. So, Daniel, I think you have another question.
Yes, sir. And thank you for sharing that. You know, it's with a group like ours where we do so much remotely. You know, a lot of times someone is a face on a screen or, you know, a name on a forum. And sometimes I think it's easy for us to forget that there's, you know, these people behind those. And so, you know, Alan, I think the stories like the ones you told are important because it reminds us that we're not just here, you know, dressing in fun costumes. It, you know, what is a costume to you may mean something a little bit more to somebody else. So I guess what I'm thinking after hearing these answers is, I'd like to know a little bit more about what was your first experience with the Walking Wounded? How did you get pulled into this group? You know, was there a person that helped guide you? Did you happen to, you know, see a post on a forum somewhere? What brought you to this group in the first place? And let's go ahead and we'll start with Helen this time, I think.
I think I first heard about it directly from Albin, because we sometimes chat back and forth on Facebook Messenger. And I think he mentioned it when I really started having problems with my mobility because of my knees. And he was aware of it. So, and I think he was the one who turned me on to the group. Because like I said, I wasn't even officially a 501st costumed member at the time.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Kevin, why don't we hear from you?
I think I found out through the Legion forums when it was, you know, first being proposed. And, you know, at first I was like, let's see what this thing's all about. And I can honestly say that the friendships that I've made through this detachment have been some of the strongest that I've had Legion-wide. I mean, there are people in our detachment that I truly consider family and I'd go to the wall for, just because we do support one another, you know, throughout the good things and the bad things. You know, some of our members have passed away, and it's just having that support towards their family, knowing that, you know, hey, he was a member of this detachment and I just wanted to let you all know. Being able to support the family through their griefs and letting them know stories about, you know, yeah, here's all the good things that I remember, and, you know, people going through dark times and depression, helping them out, you know, letting them know, you know, hey, I've been there, you know, I've hit rock bottom just like you, but I'm still here and I won't let the demon get me today, you know, because I know if I go to sleep and I rest on it and I wake up in the morning, it's a brand new day. So I think, you know, finding out about it through the Legion forums has been one of my best experiences being a part of the Legion today.
Well, thanks. That's a great answer, and it resonates with me somewhat as well. A lot of what you said, Alan. I'm wondering if you had kind of similar experiences when it comes to how you joined and what you found when you did.
Yeah, kind of. It was a little bit different, somewhat part of other things. But originally, when I joined the 501st. I was looking for something that actually was kind of unique to this particular thing, like, for example, what we do in the Walking Wounded. I went to Albion directly, and I said, hey, Albion, let's start a new group. I didn't even know about it. I said, let's start a new group for, you know, I was thinking more towards, like, you know, military people that have been disabled and other people that have been disabled. And also, you know, I've seen pictures with, you know, figures of, you know, Star Wars figures that have been just left on the ground and stuff like that. So I was thinking that might be a good idea to do. Then Albion kind of said, hey, you know, we have a group already. And I was like, okay, what do you all do? And he kind of told me, and he says that it would be very good to start getting, like I was telling him about the military and other things in there. And he said, you know, you might want to join, see if you like it. And once I got there, I was hooked. I mean, it was, I saw some of the posts that were there. People are, I mean, we're very respectful of what they do. I think that's why people do post. I like that part, but on the same part is we get a lot of people on the outside that aren't, don't have some sort of disabled that they want to try to help also. And we let them post, but they just can't see all the stuff at times. But it made me want to stay. It made me want to stay. It made me want to be better and help them out as best as I can. And that's when I ended up being a moderator for, you know, the group itself. And then I also met a lot of good people. And people that said they had some sort of disabilities and stuff like that, I thought they were stronger than a lot of people that don't. I think that what they go through, and that made me want to be there more. And I had the same thing. I understood what they were going through. So I wanted to, like I said, that's how I found out about it. That's how come I joined it. And that's how come I'm here right now talking to you all.
Thank you for the answer. And I think you know, if we could get more people from the detachment on this, you know, today, you know, somehow we would get, you know, a variety of answers, but I think it would all kind of point back to the same basic theme of this is a place where a lot of us feel like we fit, we belong. And that's, you know, that's an important theme to have. Alan, I think you have another one ready to go, right?
Yeah, I have one more real quick. It might be kind of overlapping, but it is, just be patient with it. Now, I know all of us have challenges to do the troops, correct? And how do you mentally get through the troops? Helen?
I think for me, it's more... having to deal with having my face hidden. That's more of a mental preparation for me, because my physical challenges are always there. I'm accustomed to dealing with them, but sometimes I do just have to steel myself for, okay, I can do 5 more minutes or I can do 5 more minutes. But then by the same token, because we have physical challenges, we have to remember that it's okay to tap out sometimes. It's okay to say, okay, my knees cannot take another 5 minutes. I need to sit down. And I think having our support systems and our handlers can be an important way of getting through a troop, and using them as a resource, and just being kind to yourself that it's okay to take 5 minutes, go in the back, take your helmet off, for me, take my hood off, you know, and take a break. And if you take 5 minutes, 10 minutes as a break, you might be able to do another hour. So we have to be kind to ourselves first, because unless we take care of ourselves first, we can't take care of anybody else.
It's very, very good answer, Helen. I 100% agree. And you are right on the dot. Kevin?
I think for me, it just begins with being better prepared. You know, this troop's coming up. So rather than getting all stressed out on the day, you know, get everything packed together, everything you think you're going to need, and have it ready the night before, so that you know when you do get to the troop that that's all you have to concentrate on. You don't have to concentrate on fixing anything, on, you know, anything else but just being there and trooping. And I think the understanding of my fellow brothers and sisters in my garrison, that understand what problems I'm going through, we kind of watch out for each other. So if we do notice that someone's struggling or someone needs water or someone needs a rest, you know, we'll just tap each other on the shoulder. Hey, you doing okay? You need a break? You know, being mentally prepared, you know, just for me, being prepared for it releases that part of the stress away from trooping so I can concentrate on just doing what I need to do. And when it gets to the point where my body just says, you know, hey, enough's enough, I can go to being a handler. I can sit down at the table. I can talk to people about the Legion. So, you know, I'm still there. I'm still at the troop. I'm just not in costume, but I've done what I could. And that's the best anyone can ever expect. You know, you do the best you can.
Kevin, yeah, you're on the, I mean, that's good preparation. So I do similar to that. What I do is before I leave, I'm talking about the night before, I'll actually get in my gear to make sure everything's good. I'll have my kid go around me and take a look at it and make sure it's good, because I know when I'm there, I can't be bending over and doing all the different things. So I have to do it while I'm home. Then if I'm home, I can always sit down, take a break. You know how that is. So, but Daniel, how about you?
You know, after listening to what you guys say, I think that my answer is just kind of a amalgamation of what everybody else said. Some of it is preparing, you know, making sure that you have what you need the day of. So, you know, if you need, you know, your, you know, medications or whatever, you know, I need something at, you know, a certain point in the day, I have it. Some of it is knowing what your limits are and not pushing beyond what you're able. And then, you know, some of it is just, I guess the flip side of that is knowing when you can push. You know, a lot of times in you know, daily life, you have to sit down, you know, and say, okay, you know, I got to pace myself. But there are sometimes that, you know, I'll be at one of our events and I will go longer than maybe I should, or maybe is comfortable because, you know, I'm there. And, you know, the moment is now, you know, strike while the iron is hot. And, you know, if I need to do something to make up for it later, then, you know, I will. So if I, you know, but I think there's a part of that too. And I have yet to meet the person in this group that will say, I have a hard stop time, and then they'll walk away. You know, if someone's trying to take a photo or something, you know, we're all there to do something, and none of us are very good at walking away from someone who wants or needs something. So I think that's part of it too.
Yeah, that's a very good Daniel. I mean, you kind of brought up a big point on there, is that we do have our points of what we can do, just because of our abilities, and, you know, but on the same part is, we do like making people happy, and for us to walk away, that's not a thing that we would do. I mean, the walking wounded, we are walking and we're wounded, but we still continue the mission, and the mission is making people happy and making what we can. So anyways, Daniel, do you want to do a closing?
Yeah, I actually do have a question to close with. And again, for those of you who are watching us, thank you so much for helping us support Make-A-Wish, and please keep it up. We have just a couple hours left, and we are really pushing hard. We set a very optimistic goal, and we're pushing hard to get there, and every little bit helps. So I guess my closing question to you is, we've talked some over, you know, about the, you know, the challenges and things like that. My question for you guys here is, how does being in the walking wounded and these, you know, some of these challenges, how have you turned that into a positive? You know, and we hear that a lot in our society today, and sometimes it's kind of aggravating, you know, people acting like, oh, well, you know, just because they have some problem, that means they should be extra happy. But how have you seen that turn to a positive, you know, into a positive experience for you? Alan, why don't we start with you?
Well, I mean, just by me seeing people internally from our own organization under the Walking Wounded to outside people, just by me doing what I do, knowing that I hurt it actually is a positive to see myself get to the next point without stopping. That means that I've finished a mission. I hate to use the word mission all the time. I know it sounds militaristic, but I finished a mission and it kind of says, okay, I made it there. And at that point, it's, I mean, if you can see my skin right now, I'm getting these goosebumps right now. And it's just, it becomes very positive. And then also like my son and my niece and other people that are around me, they see me doing things that they thought I couldn't do through our organization. And I do it, I finish it. Like for example, the parade that we just had. I mean, that was hard with the wind and everything like that. I think everybody knows about that. And for me to continue on through that without just saying, forget this, I'm walking out of here, was a big thing. It makes me feel so good and so proud. I guess that's more of the word I do, proud of what I do. I know this is a hobby, but it's also becoming a lifestyle for me. So that's mine. Next.
Yeah, I think you're right. You know, we all say this is a hobby and then we proceed to dump, you know, time and money into it like it's going out of style. So I don't know. Hobby is the right word for it. Kevin, what about you?
I think when, you know, you have a disability and you're on your own, you tend to sulk and get depressed. And, you know, you feel like, you know, I don't know if I could do this anymore. You know, is this the best my life's ever going to be? And I think in being a part of a support group, like the Walking Wounded Detachment, you know, you're not alone. You have the support of your brothers and sisters that honestly do care about you. And if you're sitting there sulking and you're wallowing in your own self-pity, you know, someone's going to kick you in the butt and tell you, you know, hey, you know, things can always be worse. And, you know, you've got positive things ahead of you. Here's some things that you may not have thought of that'll help relieve your pain and so forth. And I think it's, you know, letting you know that you're not suffering in silence. You've got people that care about you and genuinely want to help you out.
Yeah, I don't think you're far wrong there. The Walking Wounded is definitely not a great group for wallowing, you know, because it seems like every time I go on there feeling sorry for myself, you know, there's somebody else who posts and go, wow, you know, that's much harder than what I'm doing, you know? And so you're right. It's, I think there is that dynamic there that you don't often think of. Helen, how about you?
Well, listening to the rest of you, the one thing that occurred to me was trooping and being part of the Walking Wounded Detachment, that even with our challenges, at the end of the day, us getting up and trooping is a sense of accomplishment. I think it is something we can all be proud of that, wait, I have all of these things that it could make it very easy for me to not get out there and not do these things, but I did it. And it's very motivational and a sense of accomplishment internally that we did this. Despite everything that could have kept us home, we didn't let it stop us.
Yeah, I think you're right. And I can really identify with that. You know, when there, I don't know if you guys have ever had this experience, but sometimes there's an event that comes up and I go, man, I don't know if I can do this or not. You know, this is going to be a rough one. And then you do it and you're like, wow, you know, I'm done. You know, that's a big achievement for me. So yeah, I'm right there with you, Alan. I think we're within just the last couple of minutes here. Any closing remarks?
I just want to thank everybody for coming and watching us and listening to us, and hopefully you all learn something from us too, that you can continue on, can persevere and do whatever you need. But also, if you know anybody that wants to, you know, come to the Walking Wounded site, let them come on in. Anyone who'd like to come in, let us know. I just want everybody to have a great holiday and think about others too, you know, pass on, as they say, you know, pass the gift on. That's all I have to say.
Thanks, Alan. Helen, you have any like final things you'd like to add?
No, I think that was a great sentiment to end with, especially this time of the year. The phrase that came to mind for me was pay it forward.
Yep.
And always pay it forward.
Yeah, that's That's a really spectacular thing to say, and it's all the more remarkable that, you know, that's a sentiment that we're hearing from, you know, from this group, you know, of everyone, you know, the idea that we pay, you know, want to keep paying forward is, you know, that's a good one. Kevin.
Yeah, I agree with pay it forward, and also be a good wingman, you know, take care of your brother and sister beside you. If you notice someone's suffering, someone's down in the dumps, you know, you don't have to be their savior, but you can help point them in the right direction. And if you feel you need a friend, come join us at the Walking Wounded. You know, we're the biggest family of supporters that you'll ever know.
Thank you all very much for joining us tonight. And Alan, thank you for all your work in preparing for this panel tonight. The next panel that we have coming up for those of you who are watching is called We Bring Action Figures to Life. And we're gonna get to talk to some of the people who actually make the stuff that we have to figure out how to wear. So I'm anticipating learning some things that I didn't know before during that panel. Again, we're 2 hours left. You know, right after the action figures panel, we have our very own From Garrison Tyrannus, Serrano Squadcast guys coming on to close us out. So we have 2 hours left, and we're really counting on those of you who are watching to help us get closer to our goal. Thank you all very much for joining us, and we hope to have you here again, again as soon as we can. Thanks, and have a good evening.
Thank you.
Thank you for hosting. Donate if you can.